Thank you, Rose, and thank you for the invitation to discuss some thoughts about the annals. As you may know, we're in the midst of a transition, not only new editor, but a new editorial office, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that. And I have some words about the immediate short-term future and the long-term future of the annals of thoracic surgery as well. So this year commemorates the 50th anniversary of the Annals of Thoracic Surgery. The Annals was first published in 1965, 1 year after the STS was formed. And at the time of its inception, the Annals was the recognized as the official journal of the STS and the Southern Thoracic Surgical Organization. There's been four editors in the Annals history thus far. John Steele was appointed the first editor by the STS Board of Directors in 1964. It took him about a year to get the publication up and running. John Steele was actually quite a well-known thoracic surgeon. He made major contributions to the understanding of the surgical management of tuberculosis. He was a member of the Trudeau Society, which is the forerunner of the American Thoracic Society, and was actually the president of the Trudeau Society for a year back in the late 50s. He unfortunately developed an abdominal malignancy and died in 1969, at which time his editorship was taken over by Herb Sloan, who directed the Annals for about 15 years, passing the editorship on to Tom Ferguson in 1980, I believe. And Tom served in that capacity for a number of years and was succeeded by Hank Edmonds, who has served for 15 years as the editor of the Annals of Thoracic Surgery. I have to acknowledge Hank's assistance and support for me in this transition, and he's been a terrific editor and a very grateful. I'm very grateful for all that he's done for me over the course of these past year or so. So this is a look at the front page of the Annals in the very first issue of the Annals back in 1965, Volume 1, Number 1. And I show you this just for a couple of reasons, to depict the short, the very small number of editorial board members. You may be able to read some of those names, but they're all very noteworthy figures in thoracic, cardiothoracic history. And as part of our commemoration of this 50th anniversary, we've selected 12 manuscripts from that first volume of the Annals from 1965, and are celebrating those landmark papers with commentaries that have already begun to appear. The first one was written in the February issue of the Annals this year, and was relates to education, and the commentary was written by Ed Verrier. And I think those will be a very nice a series of contributions. They all represent important problems in 1965, and they're still important problems to consider. Now, in addition to those 1965 papers, we've also, with the help of the publisher Elsevier, identified a series of landmark papers that were published throughout the history of the Annals during the remaining 49 years. And three of those landmark papers will be featured and commented on in each issue of the Annals in 2015. I don't know if you noticed, but in the February issue, tribute was paid to Dr. Ellwesser, to Dr. Ankeny, who just a former STS president, who just recently died, and also to Will Seeley, who was a famous cardiac surgeon, was among the first to study the surgical management of cardiac arrhythmias. So this just depicts what the April issue is going to look like on the cover. So to your left is Donald Ross, and of course there's commentary about his famous paper describing the Ross procedure. Griff Pearson, who everybody recognizes very well and acknowledges his contributions, but he published a very early paper on the pathology and management of benign airway strictures as a result of tracheostomy complications, either stomal or cuff strictures. A very important paper then and still is. And Bill Gay, to your right, who can be credited, I think, with the development of potassium cardioplegia, a very important paper from the mid-70s when cardiac surgery was a little bit unreliable for fear of stopping the heart and having some sense that it might actually start again at the end of the operation. So Bill's contributions are legendary, and he's recognized in the April issue. Some of you will remember the way the Annals appeared many years ago. I have no idea who came up with that ugly color, but anyway, it seemed to persist for quite a while. Actually, here's 10 years later, we're still dealing with that same more or less gastrointestinal color, it looks to me, but anyway. But I show this slide just to illustrate the importance and the concern that Herb Sloan had for the Annals. And he wrote what might be termed the mission statement of the Annals, to provide a place for all thoracic surgeons to relate experiences which help other practicing thoracic surgeons give better patient care. So this quote appears in every issue of the Annals as of 1984, when Tom Ferguson took over the editorship of the Annals. And we're actually having a strategic planning meeting for the Annals sometime this summer, and one of the things we're going to address is the mission statement, and we might come up with a different mission statement, but it'll be hard to improve on the one that Herb Sloan gave us many years ago. All in, there's been more than 29,000 manuscripts published in the history of the Annals, the majority of them from North America, but in recent years, a really striking increase in the number of manuscripts from Asia, particularly from China, and a steady third or so from Europe. It's interesting to look at the content of the Annals over the years. So here's a word cloud created by Elsevier. These are terms used most commonly in manuscripts published in 1965. And not much about, and the size of the word, it reflects its frequency of appearance in manuscripts published. And not a whole lot of cardiac work at that time, but it's certainly transformed. Here we have the most recent year, 2014. And you'll see a good distribution of both cardiac and pulmonary topics. And buried in the middle of that, but still in sizable print, is the whole concept of patience. And that's I'll get to that a little bit later in my talk, the importance of our patients and how we serve them best. Now, we've also developed this year Annals in a Chinese format. This happens to be the general thoracic version, although I can't tell you exactly where it says that on the cover. But in any case, this is the thoracic version, and there is a cardiac version that's going to be coming out very soon. This is a new venture for us, and hopefully it will be a popular feature for our Chinese colleagues. Now, this does not display very well. I'm sorry, there's quite a few names, but it illustrates the dramatic increase in the size of the editorial board. But we've increased the number of deputy editors. There's now three cardiac deputy editors, Jim Gammy, John Kern, Jennifer Lawton. On the congenital side, two deputy editors, Scott Bradley and Jennifer Hirsch Romano from Michigan. And on the general thoracic side, Mark Ferguson has stayed on as a deputy editor, and Jim Lukatich joins him as well. We have a new biostatistics editor, Graham Kolditz, who's a colleague of mine at WashU. Colleen Koch runs the CME program. I have to say that has been a phenomenally successful program with thousands of surgeons participating and getting CME credit. There are three new deputy editor positions, and I'll discuss a little more detail subsequently. And those are Tom McGilvery, who's looking after education, Doug Mathiesen, looking after public policy, and Richard Prager, looking after quality. And I'll explain the background for that in subsequent slides. And also, I want to just thank Shanda Blackman for agreeing to serve as a deputy editor for interactive learning. I'll have more to say about how that applies to the future of the Annals subsequently. And this is just the rest of the members of the editorial board, quite a few new members, and all outstanding surgeons making good contributions to our specialty. The editorial office is located now at the SDS headquarters in Chicago, and the address, phone number, email, and all that is shown on that slide. More importantly are the actual people who are in those positions. The editorial staff has for 15 years been in Philadelphia, those individuals, although we tried to recruit all of them to join us in Chicago, none of them would relocate, so we had to develop an entirely new editorial office team. Kavitha Reinhold comes to the Annals from the ACGME Journal, and she's done a great job for the past few months directing the organization as managing editor. John Kirpan comes to us from the Blue Journal, the Pulmonary Journal, American Journal of Pulmonary and Critical Care Medicine. Actually, all he had to do was move across the street because the editorial office for that journal is at Northwestern, right? Yeah, so he's been a terrific addition. And Kimberly Cleary just joined us a couple of weeks ago as an editorial coordinator, and we have one more position to fill. Sheila Hall is my assistant in St. Louis. The publisher is Elsevier. They've been the publisher for some 25 years now. We're currently in a contractual renegotiation with them. Hopefully that'll work out. Now, I want to just say a little bit about the work that Shanda has done to try and spruce up the Annals and get it into the 21st century. This is the Twitter page, I have no idea how this works, but Shanda's an expert. And anybody who wants to know the story of the little gnome, I'd be happy to share that with you later. And of course, the Annals is doing its best to become more mobile. This is just some depiction of text and content from the Annals app, which is available for download to Apple devices. And they're working on the Android application of this. Hopefully, it'll be done in a few months. But so I think that just gives you a bit of a flavor of what we have in mind and what we think we can accomplish what future opportunities we have for the Annals. Now, let me just spend the remaining time that I have just talking about some of the issues that I think are critical and that I hope the Annals can take advantage of. You've all noticed a dramatic change in our annual meetings, particularly STS, where focus on quality, health policy, education have been very, very preeminent. The STS makes enormous investments in quality through the database, through guidelines preparation. Health policy is a big opportunity for the STS, big investment with our STS PAC and the office in Washington. And they've also made heavy investments in education. And that's why I've asked Richard Prager to serve as the deputy editor for quality, Doug Mathiesen to serve as deputy editor for health policy, and Tom McGilvery for education. Each of those individuals chairs those organizational components within the STS. And I think By focusing on these items, I think we can generate better, more broad publications reflecting our interest in quality. For example, publish an annual database report. I think it'd be terrific for the specialty. There's been all kinds of action on health policy. We have people in all of our programs studying health policy, another terrific opportunity. And something that I think we don't spend enough time on, and yet there are people publishing papers on this, presenting them at our annual meeting, I would cite the work of Keenan Yount from Virginia, the young surgical cardiothoracic trainee who did an MBA during his training. And he's published one paper after another, presented one paper after another, studying efficiency in the operating room, studying the cost and downsides of doing cases late in the day. Very important contributions, and he's done that through a very tight association with the Darden School at UVA. We have a similar arrangement with the Olin School at WashU. So I think there's all kinds of opportunities for us in the field of health management, and all of us are asked to manage complex organizations within our own hospitals and institutions. So I think it's a good opportunity for the annals to take advantage of that. And finally, platform. It just gives us a chance to kind of think about making the thing more mobile, you know. And here I'm still reading this, you know, but half the people in this room are not reading this, they're reading this. And we need to get switched. We're going to talk about wiki and paper and so on. Let me just say that for the moment, we have to move to more mobile platforms, but the publishers are terrified about that prospect. They do not want to do away with the paper journal yet, but there's going to be a significant transition over the next few years, and we want to position the annals to take advantage of that. Thank you very much.